The power of life and death is in my mouth. I shall speak words of life and not of death, of health not of sickness, of wealth not of poverty, of blessing not of curse, for there's a miracle in my mouth. Just give your best clap offering to the Lord and His Word. And to those tuning in to us from their home, this is Casa de Dios, your casa. We're waiting for you here with open arms. You may all be seated, please. All right, then. In our last message, I was speaking to you about our assignment and our configuration. And we need to understand that the way we were configured is a great part of what helps us fulfill our assignment in life. And by assignment, I mean that which I'm called to fulfill or do in life. Now, nothing that anyone does should ever be looked down on. For example, a shoemaker. Without them, we'd all be walking around barefoot. Do you know how important shoemakers are in life? And how invaluable good shoemakers are, or a tailor? We can't be thinking little or less of these tasks, otherwise we'd be walking around naked. We wouldn't have any clothes on to wear. Nor a cook, right? Those that help out at home. The person that serves your coffee. These are each important assignments in our daily lives, because to one degree or another, we also receive part of their benefit in our own lives as well. Are you following me here? So then there's no such thing as that the corner store owner or the grocery store owner isn't that important. Of course his assignment in life is important. No, it's not just about those political positions that people aspire to have in a certain administration that are important, right? But those desires that you have, they're also important. And the better you fulfill them, the more valuable you'll be to society, to your family, and to the body of Christ. Assignments and configurations. Are you following me here? Everyone has their assignment and their configuration. Jesus had an assignment, which was to save the world. And he prepared himself for that assignment. But how was Jesus going to carry out that assignment? By giving his body as a sacrifice. Now, how well do you think Jesus must have taken care of his body? If he was going to present as a sacrifice his body, he never had to sacrifice his spirit. He didn't have to sacrifice his soul. In fact, his spirit never died. He gave it unto the Father. What died was his body. What resurrected was his body. Therefore, he must have taken care of his body, because in order to fulfill his assignment, caring for his physical configuration was quite vital. John chapter 4 and verse 31 says, "In the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, Rabbi, eat. But he said unto them, I have food to eat of which you do not know. Therefore the disciples said to one another, Has anyone brought him anything to eat? And Jesus said to them, My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." Jesus trained himself up to fulfill his assignment or his realization. Jesus prepared throughout 30 years for those 3 years of ministry expression which he carried out. But in addition to that, Jesus knew all too well that his energy, more so than from normal food, was going to consist of him fulfilling the work that his Father had commanded him. Listen, when you really are, but I mean fully involved in a vision, whether it's at work, at home, or in your family, you're just so immersed in it that there are times that you even forget to eat. Why? Because we're so engrossed in something that you totally forget about eating. And Jesus forgot to eat that day. Yeah, they probably brought him something to eat. He goes, no. There's another type of food that you all aren't aware of, that you need to learn to eat as well. Because when you're really doing the Father's will and you're carrying out your assignment, that assignment, it injects you with energy. Now I better understand that verse in the book of Proverbs that says, if you faint in the day of pressure, your strength will be small. The more you rest, the more idle and slothful you become. The more you rest in life, the less energy you'll have. Are you following me? John chapter 12 and verse 24, please. Now, Jesus knew something here. Yes? Beforehand. In other words, he knew something that was to take place here. And he says in verse 24, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain." So it's talking about sacrifice here, yes? And these are the moments that we all try to avoid in life, right? Those moments of discomfort, and not about dying on the cross, because that's the one that Jesus had to go through. But there are moments in life when you just want to go, oh, I just want to die. I remember the other day someone coming to me and going, oh, I just feel like I'm going to die. I'm dying here. So I go, well, then stop fighting it. Because once you're dead, you aren't going to feel anything then. So then just go for broke already. And that's it. Problem over. Because it's in those moments that you've got to know in life. You see, there's no worse thing than to believe that everything good in life is going to come without sacrifice. And that's so not it. When I first started off in college, my economics professor, I remember him telling us, I've gone to school, majored in economics, graduated with honor, did this, did that, I've done this, I've done that. But there is one catch, though. Throughout those 4 years of college, I never even saw an hour's worth of TV. But I can see that some of you already graduated with honors in binge watching. Huh? Yoo-hoo. And he went on, if you really want to be successful in life, then it's going to require sacrifice. I mean, even Jesus had to use a sacrifice to save us. Then how can we be wanting everything in life without having to sacrifice? If sacrifice is designed to be a normal part of a good and fulfilling life. Sacrificing for something is a good part of what'll bring us enormous satisfaction at the end of our race. And knowing that we've sacrificed for a decent cause, knowing that we worked hard for something, that we've shed many sleepless nights, obviously under the loving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul would say, I am what I am through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he also said, and I've labored harder in this grace more than all the other apostles. And if God confides a grace to you, then work hard at it. But if you've been a person that's always looking for the easy way out, if you're always looking for shortcuts here and shortcuts there, no, come on, it's not going to end up right. And if you stay on that path, then I don't have to be a prophet to be telling you that your life is going to have a bad turnout. Jesus knew that a sacrifice was on the way. Then he knew that he had to go through it. And he also got offers to try to work around it. Even his closest apostles go, why don't we stay here and make 3 tabernacles? Huh? That way we'll have you here and Elijah and Moses and we'll just settle it. And he goes, hey, hold on, I've got to go down to Jerusalem. And I've got to die in Jerusalem. But he also knew something, that after dying, he wouldn't be left alone, but that he would bear much fruit. And we are all a part of that fruit. And every time he sees you, he's filled with so much satisfaction. And he feels fulfilled and satisfied with it. Hebrews 12:1 says, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, in other words, that holds us back, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. Now please pay close attention. The word discourage here in the original Greek, in the original language it says, it means to wane, to loosen, to lose strength, or in other words, to weaken, to relax, and to be without mental strength. So then what it says here is what the Lord says. Whenever you go through those uncomfortable times or moments in your assignment in life, those moments that you're wanting to avoid, those moments that you're wanting to elude because they're uncomfortable, but you know that they're the right ones, and you need to go through them in life, it says, set your eyes on Jesus. Set your eyes on the Lord. So that you won't wane or lose strength or become weak and fragile in your mental endurance, set your eyes on Jesus and consider
how much hostility he endured from sinners
for the sake of fulfilling his mission, which was to save us. So then you can have those moments or go through those moments, and I get you. I mean, I totally do, for real. There are moments when you just don't want to go on, when you just don't want to continue. There are moments when you just feel like this is no good anymore. It's not worth it. I can't stand it. I can't bear it. There's no point to it. And that's your mental strength talking there. And he goes, exactly when you're going through that moment in time, just raise your eyes and set your sight on Jesus, who suffered such hostility from sinners, and inspire yourself to press on forward and not look back. Jesus, everyone talks about the holes in his hands, in his feet, and lastly, in his side. You know, but I'm still not sure if those were the most painful ones. But the Bible says in the book of Psalms that the plowers, they plowed on his back and made their furrows long. You see, what we see on the front, the wounds that he has on his chest, they don't even begin to compare to the ones that he has on his back. That having opened up his skin into long furrows, he then had to stick his back to a piece of splintered wood. And there you see the reason why Jesus took such good care of his body. When I first saw the movie, The Passion, and Jesus was kneeling there, and he was being flogged, I could hear the Lord's voice right there in my ear. Now you understand why I took such good care of my body. I cared for my entire life to present it as a flawless sacrifice unto my Father out of my love for you. What need did Jesus have of dying between two sinners as if he was a sinner himself? None whatsoever. But Jesus Christ endured the cross out of his love for us, and he saved us. And he goes, and the book of Hebrews goes, when you're right on the verge of giving up, consider him. You see, we're all wanting the benefits of the cross, but we don't all want to love the one who died on that cross. Oh yes, we're longing for the benefits of his cross. Salvation, forgiveness, prosperity, healing. But we don't always yearn for the one that had to give his life on that cross. Now how do I know if you've really entered into maturity? When you're fully aware that you've got the benefits of that cross, but you love even more so the one who endured it. Just look at what Isaiah chapter 53 says. Who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. His death was totally misunderstood. I mean, people even started believing that he was a criminal, a sinner. Yet what he was doing was laying down his life for us. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted. Watch this now. Yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. Why is it that whenever something happens to you, in light of everything that Jesus suffered, it's really insignificant? And instead of choosing not to open our mouth, The first thing we do is to get together with some friends or people from church even.
To open our mouth up.
Whenever they invite you to a gripe meeting, don't attend. Because you're going to end up contaminating yourself with the attitude of people that are continually finding fault in someone or something to complain about. But coming together to gripe and accuse and complain, and to claim to want to be like Jesus, just doesn't line up. Because Jesus was taken as a lamb before his shearers. And it says that he remained silent. He didn't open his mouth. He laid down his body to lovingly save each and every one of us. And I invite you to follow the example set forth by our Lord Jesus. And don't be coming together in meetings to just speak that which is wicked or evil. And verse 8 goes on to say here, he was taken from prison and from judgment. And who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was stricken. And they made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death. Because he had done no violence, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Verse 11, he shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. You see, he knew all too well that if the grain of wheat didn't fall to the ground, he'd be left alone. But he also knew something else, that if it died, he would bear much fruit. Therefore, he went through all that suffering, fixing his eyes on what was to come. And the scriptures all say that because of the joy set before him, he suffered the shame. So then what the Father was really offering him then was the joy of saving mankind. But he first had to go through the pain of the act of salvation itself. But every time he sees us, no wonder the Bible says that whenever one person comes to repentance, there's a celebration up in heaven. And why is there so much celebration? Because he sees the fruit of the affliction of his soul and he feels how? Satisfied. And everything that we do in life is the same. Every time that you get that report card, that college diploma, or that business that you work so hard for, there's a sense of satisfaction from all that sacrifice that you had to endure. And in that same way, Jesus was pleased when he looked at you and he looked at me coming to his feet. Now, what do you think is a stronger feeling in Jesus? Let's say in his emotions. The joy of seeing you saved or the pain of having saved you? What do you think causes a stronger sentiment in him? I just want you to think for a moment on the pain he must have endured there. It's beyond description. So intense that he even goes to the Father, why have you forsaken me? And do you know why? Because at that very moment, Jesus was carrying my sins and yours as well. Now then, that intense pain can in no way compare with the even greater joy of seeing you serving him and worshiping him with all your heart 2,000 years later. John chapter 2 and verse 19, and this is a revelation that's able to transform your life forevermore. John 2:19 says, Jesus answered and said to them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Then the Jews said, it has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. Therefore, when he had risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this to them. And they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had what? Had said to them. Now watch this now, please. Look at this. Jesus, he saved us out of love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. You see, he gave his own family to save yours. Therefore, we are called to place our families at his service to save others as well. And that's how I correspond to his love. He gave me his family, so I can offer up mine now. Are you following me here? Now notice this. He saved us out of love, yes, but he gave himself in faith. He saved us out of love, but he had to give himself in faith. In faith, yes. And that's why he would say to them, he was so sure that he goes, destroy this temple, and I'll raise it back up in 3 days. So then what he basically had was the faith that 3 days after dying, he would visit them again because he was going to rise up and be resurrected. And that's what it means to walk by faith and not by sight. Why? Because if Jesus needed the faith to give his life on that cross, then you're going to need faith to go through the processes in your life. And out of all those processes, what brings you out is your faith. Because it was faith that brought Jesus out of the grave. He believed it and said, I love you and I'm going to save you. But mind you why I lay down my life, because I believe that I'm going to get back up again. Amen? Just give me your best clap offering here. Oh, you can do better than that. He lives. He rose again. And he's seated at the right hand of the Father with a name that's above every other name. So that all those in heaven, on the earth, and beneath the earth might bow their knee and confess that Jesus Christ alone is Lord.